I'm Dr. Lisa Goins with Couture Healthcare. And the question today is, when I go into the exam room, what could happen to me? Well, when you come into the exam room, you may or may not have already had your weight taken. And then we need what's called vital signs. And vital signs is a list of information from your body. So we will start with things like a blood pressure cuff. And the blood pressure cuff will be put on your arm, like so. And it's kind of hard to do since I'm doing it to myself, but you get the general idea. So we got the blood pressure cuff on, and then there will be a thing called a stethoscope. So you put it on, and you won't be doing it to yourself. Somebody will be doing it to you, but this is just to give you an idea. And then you will listen over this area here, and we will pump up the blood pressure cuff, and then we will turn and let it all out. And what we're listening for is two basic numbers, okay? And the numbers that we're going to look for are the numbers on the dial. Now, as the air comes out after we pumped it up, and it will squeeze, it'll be snug, and some people it may be a little painful for. So if that's the case, you may want to have a slight sleeve so that you don't bruise. And if you're on a blood thinner, please let the provider know or the attendant who's taking your blood pressure, because you could bruise, okay? And the dial will come down, and the numbers are going to be on here. Now, the numbers that you should be looking for, we start getting concerned if you are over the 140 and up, okay? The higher you go up on this dial, the more chances you are to have a heart attack, so we're kind of concerned. Now, in the same instance, if the numbers are going this way, we may need to call a code if you're going really low. Now, there is some exceptions. Like in grammar, there's always an exception, I before E after C, blah, blah, blah. There's exceptions in healthcare. And if your numbers are low, you may be an athlete. So you may be in perfectly good shape, so a low blood pressure or something like that will be normal for you, okay? Now, the other concern is 140 over 90, anything higher for a person with no diagnosis is a concern. Now, if you have diabetes, the number's not 140 over 90, it's 130 over 80 is what we're looking for, or 130 over 90, somewhere in between there. Now, your provider will know these numbers, and you may also know some of these numbers, but the number that everybody's used to hearing is 120 over 70 as being normal. Now, your normal may not be that, it may be a little lower, maybe a little higher. Now, if you're on blood pressure medicine, it's great to see those numbers come back down the dial. Now, if the numbers for diabetic, 130 and anything higher is concerning, okay? So that's blood pressure. Now the next thing that will happen is what's called a pulse oximeter. So it'll look something like this or similar. There's all kinds of different things on the market. And this little toggle is, it can be connected to a lanyard and or whatever. I choose to not use those. But what happens is there'll be a little button, it'll get turned on, and then it opens up like a little Pac-Man. If you're that old, you'll know what I'm talking about. And then you stick your finger in there. Now, if you have fingernail polish on, you may have to do it the other way, or you may have to remove your fingernail polish, or depending on the machine, okay? So you stick your finger in there, and then it's going to give you a reading, and the top number will be, as you can see, I'm a little excited. My heart rate is 108-ish, 110, and my saturation's a 98, pretty good considering I'm talking. So basically, the top number is saturation, it's how much oxygen is in your blood, and the little red light in there goes through your finger, and it counts, and it does all the scientific stuff that makes this little thing really cool, because we used to not have these. But it will tell me saturations. Now, if your saturation number is below a certain number, then you will need oxygen. And if it goes really low, we kind of get very concerned on that, okay? And then your heart rate will also let us know if you're in range or not. If you're an athlete, it'll show up. Then when you get the little lines, it's reading, okay? So that's basically a pulse oximeter. Now, the old-fashioned way to do a pulse is you put your fingers right here or right there, and you have some other places for pulses, and you just put it in there and you count for a full minute, and that gives you the same number, which is kind of nice that the machine's doing it, so while the machine's doing it, you can talk or whatever. The next thing that you're going to have done is a temperature reading. Now, there's all kinds of machines and gadgets for doing the temperatures. This one, in particular, you go slides across the forehead, and then it'll read. And, 98.1, so I'm doing good. And 98.6 is the temperature that is considered normal. Now, there are temperature thermometers that you can put in your mouth, and there's also ones for infants that we do rectally, and that's to get a core temperature, because arms and limbs are often cooler on a child. They have a smaller area of skin that can do heat and things like that. So that's the reason why we do that. And so when you go take a child in to a pediatrician, a pediatric nurse practitioner or provider, you're going to have to undress the child and take their diaper off, and there'll be a rectal temperature, and they don't really care for that. And then as you get older, then they'll probably stick it underneath, there'll be a smaller unit. They'll stick it underneath your arm. That's one way to do it. Stick it in your mouth, put it underneath your tongue. And if you're using the glass thermometers, please hold on to it. Like me, when I was a child, I chose not to hold on to mine, and it hit the ground, and we had mercury all over the place. And mercury is toxic to the human body. It causes the Mad Hatter problem from Alice in Wonderland. So, because there was mercury was used to cure the inside of a hat. So we don't want mercury to touch your skin. Please do not play with it. It is cool. They use it in special effects, but they also handle it appropriately. So if you're using glass thermometers, please be careful. And then also make sure that if you're using glass thermometers rectally, that you get them removed. They don't stay in there, okay? But most people are using some kind of new fangled gadget, new tricorder type temperature gauge, okay? Now, the other thing is the famous stethoscope. Stethoscopes come in every kind of size that you can think of, every color, every brand. Some of them are specially made just to hear the hearts, and then some are very generic that we use in hospitals for infection control. So they're disposable ones, because it's just not worth it to keep it. We just toss it away and dispose of it, okay? But most people have a regular stethoscope. Basically, it will go into the provider's ears, and they're going to listen, or auscultate. They're going to listen to the lungs, and they're gonna listen to the front, maybe the sides and the back. They'll also listen to your heart, and they may go to all the different points for the heart, depending on if you have any heart disease or there's any concerns, or you're having a sports physical. They want to make sure that you're not going to be out there playing basketball and then be on the news later because you fell over, okay? So they listen for all those things, and then they also move down and they listen to the stomach, and they might ask you, said, did you eat today? Because they can hear whether your stomach's growling or not. And then the other thing too is it has two different backsides and twist. This one is often used, this side, this bell is often used for children to hear. We can hear a little bit better on the side, and then this one is for more for adults. Just kind of depends. And then you may also see other attachments or special stethoscopes out there now, because we have a lot of nurses who are disabled, who have hearing problems, born with hearing or born without hearing, and they've managed to get their license, and they have to use a special stethoscope so that they can hear. Don't be freaked out about that. They can hear just as well as someone else, okay? They just need a little something extra, okay? So it's all good. And anybody can use a stethoscope, not just a doctor, not just a nurse, not just an emergency person. Anybody can use one of these. When you need it, use it, okay? Then the neat thing is, when you come into an exam room and we've listened to your heart and your lungs and all that, sometimes you might come in with sinuses, possible ear infection or something like that. And then we use a wand or a lightsaber, per se. But anyway, we have a little attachment. These are throwaways. These are disposables. This is not broke. This is for you. This is to keep one person use. And we put it on like that. Some of them snap. Some of them are different. They just do different contraptions. Some of them are connected to the wall with the actual old telephone cords. It just depends on what your provider likes. They'll have little switches. Some of them are just very simple, just with LED lights. the main purpose of these is that I'm going to be able to put this in your ear, and I'm going to be able to look through here, and I'm going to be able to see your tympanic membrane or your eardrum if I can. Now, if you haven't cleaned it out, don't be embarrassed. Sometimes people's earwax gets the best of them, even if they clean it every day. I'll let you know. You need to clean this ear out because I can't see the tympanic membrane, which is kind of a problem with me trying to figure out, do you have an ear infection or not? Some places will also clean them. There's little gadgets and little pieces that go onto these contraptions that can help scoop out and look in the ear, so that those are available. And I do have one here. You just gotta hold still. What we'll use this for is I'll put this in your ear and I'm going to look and see if your eardrum is bulging, sinking in, it's got a hole in it, there's any blood. Hopefully nothing's crawled in there. And if so, we'll have to take that out because it's not supposed to be there. But the other thing to be concerned about when you come in to see a provider is when you have piercings. If you're looking at a future piercing for your ears and you're going around the part of the ear and across this way, try to avoid these, or if you can, try to take those out so we can get in around those. I don't want to rip those out. And I don't think any other provider does. And you've paid a lot of good money to get that put in. So. If you can, keep that in mind when you're doing your piercings, that if someone needs to look in your ears, they can do that. There's limited models on, and these are a little thin and a little thick. That's kind of the best we can do. But some of us, it takes a little bit to put all the way in there to look. Other people, you can just kind of shine a light from the room and you can see their eardrum sometimes. It's just, everybody's different. If you have eardrum like that, you might want to come and see us. Might be some other problems going on. But so this is used for ears. Now also, the other thing that this is used for is we may look up your nose and we're going to look at the turbinates. There's three turbinates right here in your nose, and if they're swollen, red, and carrying on, then it's probably allergy season and you're really sick and you got everything going on. That's going to be another thing that lets us know. And then also we're going to look in your mouth and you're going to say ah, and the reason you say ah is so that it flattens down your tongue so I can see your tonsils. Now, if you don't have tonsils, I'm not going to see those, but I am going to see the back of your throat. I'm going to see your uvula. That's a little thing that dangles down, and it's going to tell me if the tonsils are swollen, if the throat's red, if there's stuff dripping down the back or anything like that. That's also going to help me decide whether or not I need to give you an antibiotic or a special spray or some other kind of medication on the market that will help clear this all up. Okay. And another thing too is if you don't want to say ah and there's some problems, you may have to get one of these. And this is individually sealed. Sometimes they're in the old fashioned little things that says tongue blades on them and they pull them out. And they all come in different containers, but this is the one that I have here. And what will happen is you'll open this up, or your provider will open this up, and they're going to take this, and then they're going to take the tongue blade out, and then you're going to stick your tongue all the way out as far as you can, and then you can see in the back of the throat. Okay, so that's kind of the purpose. Now don't go like this and fight me and make me do the whole lightsaber thing to try to get it in there, because it's, I'm good, but, and I use the force, but you kind of need to open your mouth. So I'm trying to get it in there. Best thing to do is go ah, and let me stick it in there, pull your tongue down, say ah, look in there, look at all that, and then bam, throw it away. We are done. Okay, so that's a tongue blade. So we went over the stethoscope, the thermometer, the pulse oximeter, the tongue blade. The last thing is your telephone. And when we are talking to you and trying to get your vital signs, it's really helpful if you can just hold on a minute, okay? Unless you're calling mom to let her know that, you're sick and you're seeing us. If you can just hang on to this for a little bit, that we appreciate that. Cell phones are on some of the same Wi-Fi links in the hospital as some of the programming, and things can cross over. We're trying to work to avoid those kind of things. And do not unplug anything that is plugged in, like a ventilator, to charge your cell phone, because you're going to make all the bells and whistles go off and the person's not going to be able to breathe. So try not to charge your phone like that. And if you can hold on to your messages and phone calls, we'd appreciate it, because you scheduled your appointment and we have one-on-one with you. We set that time aside just for you, all right? These people can wait 15 minutes, okay? You can do it, all right? So if you can hang on to that, that would be the last thing. So again, I'm Dr. Lisa Goins, nurse practitioner, and we're talking about vital signs and phone courtesies. And I'm Couture Healthcare CEO. And if you like this video, like, subscribe, share, and you can find us on YouTube under Couture Healthcare, under the channel. And thank you very much.